All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Naomi Hartle, and I'm on the Phys Ed Summit team. And we'd just like to welcome you here today. And go ahead, Sarah.
Hi, good morning, everybody. My name is Sarah Gitcher-Hartman, representing the Phys Edagogy team, and we are so thrilled that you're here joining us for this session, which is called Full Access Physical Education. We've got the Tazzle going on right now where you can access all the session resources, information about our presenters, and it's also going to be the place where we contact you if we experience any technical difficulties. So thanks again for joining us, and we're going to hand it over to the guys.
Hey, thanks, Sarah. My name's Andy Hare. I am a physical education teacher in the great Geelong, Victoria, down here in Australia. I can't believe this is my third Phys Ed Summit. So I'm absolutely stoked with that. And today I've teamed up with Brett and Richard, who are going to introduce themselves in a minute. And we're going to just talk about what this full access PE is. I'm going to leave it as a little secret for the moment. I've been teaching 20 years, finally changed schools after 15 years, so I'm at a brand new school learning brand new things and brand new ways, and it's driving me brand new crazy at times. So, Rich, over to you, buddy.
Hi, guys. I'm Richard Colman. I'm a World and Paralympic gold medalist from the 800 metres. So I've been doing a lot of sport the last 20 years, and I've been able to be very lucky that I've been disabled and been a wheelchair athlete. So I now am moving a bit more into coaching after having a few difficult years as an athlete, but I'm hoping to make Rio, but we'll see if it doesn't. I'd like to go and backpack a bit more around the world, and I'm sharing my stories with you of my experiences of being an athlete. So, that's a bit about me, and I'm happy to share any stories that you guys would like about disability and Paralympic sport. Over to you, Brett.
Thanks, Rich. Hi, everyone. My name's Brett Sinnett. I'm a phys ed teacher as well in the western part of Melbourne, which is and in the part of Melbourne that I work in is actually one of the fastest growing as far as population, certainly in Australia. So it's a really, really interesting dynamic. Like Andy, I've started a new school this year as well, so which is going really well, really enjoying it, getting to know new kids and new staff and all that sort of stuff. I also work as a regional coordinator for School Sport Victoria, and this is my first year doing that role as well. So, and my first Phys Ed Summit. I've watched the last few, and this is my first go up presenting, so really excited about that. We did have another guest who isn't here at the moment. We're hoping he joins us later, but his name's Ben Carbonaro, and he's a friend of mine, and I've known him for a long time through sport. And Ben has Asperger's, which is a type of autism, and hopefully he can join us because he's had a really unique involvement in sport and has been able to stay involved in sport in a lot of different ways through being a statistician at a VFL football club over here in Australia. He also works for the AFL Umpires Association, and he's also a journalist, and he's worked for Netball Australia and a lot of other roles in sport. So hopefully he joins us, and but if not, the show will go on. So thank you.
Hey Brett, do you want to introduce sort of what we've done? Because you came to me in November last year, I think it was, or early December, and had this idea that we've kind of grown. If you want to introduce full access PE and what it means, while I go out and deal with this dog.
No worries, mate. So I guess full access PE is all about, it's about adapted physical education, but in the setting of, a mainstream school where as phys ed teachers, we may be presented with a situation where we may have one or two students within a class that have special needs. And the focus of this session is going to be all around making sure that those students are included, and we find a way to include them, involve them in everything we're doing. I guess it all came about. Ben and I were just chatting over Facebook a few months ago, and he, I'm not even sure how we got into it, but he was just telling me about experiences he had at school, and some of them were negative, and some of them were positive, and you know, he had some memories about that, and it just sort of evolved from there. And I thought, you know what, we need to get this story out there, and you know, and I knew Andy obviously had a connection with Richard, and you know, he obviously has a disability too, but a different type of disability. So I just thought it'd be great to get their personal view of to be able to share their story. So
Look, I think it's a brilliant thing, and I want to be brutally honest right from the start, is that it's an area that is promoted well here in Australia, but not an area that is rolled out well because of a lack of awareness and certainly probably maybe a lack of, like, a little bit of fear too, that, you know, we tend to walk on eggshells at times. And what Rich is going to do for us today is really open up, from a personal note, how he's dealt with it, and then yourself and myself, Brett, as leading PE teachers, we're also going to then chat about the successes that we've had and really give people an insight as to the inclusive nature, hence the full access PE. So, Rich, do you want to lead the way, man, and tell us about some of the positive PE teachers you've had and what made them so great? And, you know, as a kid growing up, you know, you've been in a wheelchair all your life, and just sort of talk to us about school.
Yeah, thanks, Andy. I was very lucky. I was born with my disability with spina bifida. So spina bifida is the second most common disability in the world. So I was born with my disability, so I'm very lucky that I've grown up with my disability all the way through school. And I actually went to school where Andy's teaching now. So I finished a few years ago. I'm now a bit older than that, but I was very lucky that I had great teachers, because now I'm coaching a bit more. I'm seeing students who just don't participate in sport. And even recently, I just started coaching a girl with cerebral palsy who had never done sport in her life, and she was in year six. And now she's a top athlete and coming through the ranks really quickly. And the teachers didn't know how to include her. But I feel that I am very lucky, and the reason why I've been lucky in sport is because of my teachers back all those years ago who just put me in and didn't even think about me being involved in sport, and that's why I loved it, and I didn't get treated any differently, and that's why I think I really enjoyed it. And I think the reasons why sometimes I didn't enjoy it was the teachers were making it obvious that they were struggling to include me or didn't understand how to include a person in a wheelchair into their PE classes. So I think some of the ones that stood out were the ones who didn't make it obvious they were including me and didn't make it a big fuss that they were, yeah, they didn't go out of their way to include me in the classes. So that's the reasons I do sport now.
Yeah, and that's brilliant. And look, I'm not sure how it is in the States, but here in Australia, we've got probably, of the physical education teachers, I would estimate that 60% have chosen the career and chosen that pathway. So they're passionate. They've gone to uni, they've got a teaching degree, and they've gone, all right, I need to be involved in PE in some form. But then it's the other percentage there are put into that role. And it's when they're then faced with a student with disability there, they don't have that deep background or that emotional connection with that subject area to really push forward. And I reckon that is when we see kids suffering or being left out. I wanted to show, I'll show it in a minute, but I wanted to really talk about what you've just pointed out there, Rich, and Andy Vassily and I, we talk about this all the time, and we talk about the two important things in any classroom before you even think about skills and drills and inclusion. And I'm going to show you a quick slide that I put together today when our screen share works. And this is, I know Andy won't mind, but these are the two things: connections and relationships. And Andy and I talk about this all the time, that it is so important for us to be able to connect on some level with every single child in that classroom, and not just a child with disability. We need to connect with every single child, and then develop relationships as well. And it's imperative that those two things are done first, without even thinking about physical education, because if you can get those two things right, then you've actually got 75% of the success rate right there, because the kids are going to trust you as a person. And I was on the push bike this morning, and when I was riding along, I was talking to another rider in the group that we were riding with, and I was letting him know what my day was shaping up like and that I was presenting tonight, and he was blown away. He was a Canadian guy, and he was blown away. He's like, serious? You're... 2 a.m., what are you doing that for? And I said, well, it's so important for people to hear this message. And then he got talking about how, we talk about full access PE, we talk about students with disability and that inclusion pathway, but he went to 6 different high schools because his parents moved around. So he himself suffered from the lack of connections and relationships of the teachers and other students, because he went through that whole pathway of moving and moving and moving. So that was sort of that main reason for that conversation with Andy, and it just goes so far. Brett, did you want to add to that, mate?
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. That whole concept of relationships, and to put Ben's perspective on it, I actually first met Ben when he was about 15 or 16, when I was the assistant coach of an under-16s football team here in Melbourne. And he wasn't playing, but the coach at the time was also a teacher at his school. And Ben, being Ben, had a love of numbers and statistics around sport. So the coach actually got Ben involved in the team as a statistician, which is not something that happens at under-16 level, but Ben loved it, and he was part of the team. We actually won the premiership, the grand final that year as well, and he was part of all of that. And he actually then, because of the relationship that teacher was able to build and include him, he then followed that passion of his to then be a statistician at the senior club there, and then now he's actually moved up, and he's a statistician at a VFL club, which is the second highest level of football in the country. So it's a high level, and it's not a high paying job or anything like that, but it's something that he loves doing. So and I've actually got some notes here that I'll read from, but this all links into us as phys ed teachers, because as physical educators we play a really vital role in whether our students will grow to love physical activity or not. The experiences that they have in our classes will shape their attitude, whether they're positive or negative, towards physical activity and sport later in life. And I really think it's incumbent on us to ensure that all students have a positive experience in our PE classes. And this is it's especially true for students with special needs, because if they have negative experiences in our classes, in our phys ed classes, they may not go on to have that love of sport and may never participate in sport. And that goes for any student, really. But it's really important that we do foster that. So, that's really important. Did you want to show that YouTube clip now, Andy?
Yeah, I will. And I just want to make this real cool connection. And I was sitting at a dinner table last night with some parents from school, and we were talking about basketball, and I was, again, sharing this because I've been so excited about this. You know me, girls. I'm jumping out of my skin about this summit for the last 6 weeks. And so I was sharing it, and they told me about this kid called Ben Underwood, and you may have seen this this video clip, but we look at trying to, especially if you're in a class where kids don't identify with a student with disabilities, and you're trying to set them up, and they may be looking at these kids a little bit differently. Richard showed me the way about 5 years ago, so I want to show you this video clip, which I'm going to start showing my students at my new school, because I reckon it just really sums it up. It goes for about 3 minutes, but we won't go that long. Oh, it's called echolocation, and this kid is amazing.
I'm just going to jump in for a second. Once you share it, it might be a little bit video, or once you share the video, it might be a little bit slow for viewers that are watching right now. Can you also share the link in Tozzle after? So if it's too
slow,
then they can go and watch it. Okay, awesome.
Absolutely. Sorry, I'm just drawing it out. I had it. I learned that last year when you have a video that's inside your Google Hangout as well. It doesn't work. All right. So I'll put this link on too. So I won't blow the screen right up.
No sound, Andy.
No sound?
No. Do you have headphones in, Andy?
I do have headphones in.
If you take your headphones out, we should be able to hear the sound.
Champion. All right, let's try that.
Lost your eyes?
I was 2 years old, 2 weeks before my third birthday.
Ben had cancer in both eyes, but he discovered a way to beat his blindness.
I started clicking. I was like, I was like 6 years old.
He realized the clicking sound he made with his tongue bounced off things around him, giving him an idea what was there. Was it like seeing again?
Pretty much, yeah.
Ben says he can distinguish where the cars are as he cruises his neighborhood streets. Even though he can't see the basket he's aiming for, by listening for the distinctive echoes each makes, he can find the pole and backboard on a basketball goal and sink a basket. It becomes easy to forget that Ben is blind.
That was luck.
How else to justify my pleasure when I put a couple of goals past him? You thought you were so good.
I am good.
He is indeed. Ben beat me 5-2. Taking a walk with Ben, I was amazed at what he can see with his ears.
Well, there's a fire hydrant on the side and a car on this side. Wait, is that, no, that's the trash can or, hold on, let me see. That's a trash can? Yeah, that's a trash can. Or a recycling bin, one of those.
Yeah. Playing video games with his brother Isaiah in the assault of noise, Ben can figure out everything that's happening just by listening. How can you even separate the sound?
Because they got different voices. Nobody is going to tell him that there is an impossibility for him because there are none.
It doesn't give you any breaks because you're blind, does she?
Nah. Why should he get a break? I can't get a break.
His mother, Aquanetta Gordon, insists he should have every opportunity but no pity. But he's blind.
No, he's not. I mean, you know, to society he's blind, but that doesn't make him handicapped. He just can't see.
Ben has much the same talent as the dolphins he visited at SeaWorld, the ability to use echolocation, returning sound waves, to sense his surroundings. His clicks even told him to step around a fallen trash bin.
I don't know how you do that.
But the secret to Ben's success goes beyond his clicks. Aquanetta has always told Ben he could do anything.
Once he said to me, he says, Mom, man, I wish I could see. And then I said, well, Ben, but look what you can do. I said, if we had a blackout right now, everybody has to follow you.
Before I introduce you to Ben, we need you to please hold your applause so he can use his clicking to walk out. Please come on out, Ben, without any applause, and his mother, Aqua. Hey, Ben, it's Oprah. Welcome to the show.
Hi.
Welcome to the show. Hi, nice to see you.
Nice to see you.
There you go, right there. Have a seat. Hello, Aqua. Hi. Nice to see you, too. Welcome, Ben Underwood. You can applaud now.
So that is just an amazing video. Now, this bit broke me up yesterday. The poor kid passed away last year. From cancer, so you know he lived that life, but using that as inspiration to really give meaning to our other kids in the school is so powerful, and it's what it's what we need to do to really make a connection. So, Rich, did you want to add to any of that? I know that I've used you a lot at Leopold because we had a like kid, and it was so cool. But from your experience, from the receiving end of that provocations, how did you find, I guess, Leopold Primary School as a school for embracing students with disability?
Yeah, it's one of the most amazing schools going around, I think, and it was great to have this actual, he's a wheelchair athlete, and I actually coach him now, and we've got him in sport, and I'm now a mentor for him growing up and being there when he needs me as well, not just on the track, but in around if he needs any guidance, and that's what it's important to be in. But he was included in everything, and there was no fuss made about being included, and that's what got me involved in sport, because teachers just included me in absolutely every sport, and that's what got me in athletics. One day they were doing school athletic sports, and they said, right, Rich, what, you're doing everything? And I went, yep. And so I did everything, and that was including long jump, pushing down the long jump pit and trying to break and jump out of my wheelchair. And I didn't think about doing that back then when I was a little kid, but because all my kids in my age group were doing it, so I was naturally going to do it at my school. And I did high jump that day as well, tried to jump over the high jump bar with the legs going everywhere and did those crazy events. But unfortunately, I didn't win that event, but that's what's got me involved. And I still know the teachers still talk about that now, even when I go back and visit my old school and go, right, you were crazy, but I just did everything like everyone else. And that's what got me involved, where the teachers didn't go out of the way to make it obvious they were including me, and that's what's important, that it's not a big fuss, oh, we are including that athlete in sport, which is what we're trying to do, is everyone has got to be treated equally and fairly, which is important.
Yeah, and you taught me that. You taught me that many years ago, and you and I have known each other for a long time, and you taught me that that very notion that, you know, a child with a disability is still a child. It's up to us to make it as seamless as possible. And if they want to go full-fledged and do high jump and long jump, it's not for us to stand in their way and go, no, you can't, because it's benefiting them. Sorry, Brett, I cut you off.
No, not at all, not at all. I was just going to add that the point that Rich made about having mentors, I think that's really important. Students with disabilities need to have mentors and need to have someone to aspire to, because quite often it happens all the time in schools where we get elite athletes into schools to run clinics and that sort of stuff, and that's great for kids to see, well, you know, these guys are elite athletes and, you know, they want to aspire to that, but it's, I think it's really important, particularly if we've got disabled kids or students with special needs in our school, then we need to get people like Rich, you know, that are elite athletes into the school so that they can actually, you know, say, hey, this is a pathway for me, this is something I can do, and really aspire to doing that, because if we don't get people like Rich out there that we can see, you know, these guys are world champions, this is what they've done, kids may never know that's even an option and that's something to aspire to. So I think it's really important if schools can do that, to get elite athletes of all types out, to cater for the needs of everyone.
And that's it.
Absolutely.
Yeah, now with you two as regional coordinators of school sport, I've just come on as a school sport ambassador. So I started 20 years ago on the primary school's athletics team as a para athlete, and I've come full circle now back as a team coach 20 years later, and I'm now helping out the next generation, the 10, 11, 12-year-olds going through the next generation. Who knows, one of them may not make the Paralympics, but we've got to give them the opportunity to participate in sport and be around. And I'm actually coaching a wheelchair athlete at the moment. He's 15 and now the best junior in Australia in wheelchair track, which is a huge improvement over the last 2 years. And when he first started, he was probably 10, 15 kilos overweight, and all he wanted to do was get involved, and he had motivation, and he just wanted to push around. And his first thing was, will I lose weight? And I went, yeah, okay, if that's the goal. And we helped him. And first year, 6 months, he lost 5-10 kilograms, and he's positive. He turned around and was able to smiled when he came to training and was positive talking to everyone, and that's the power of being involved. And he's now this delightful kid, and he's changing subjects around at school, and now he's aiming to go to university where he never dreamt of being able to go to university, which is such an important factor in life for people with disabilities, being positive.
Oh, absolutely. And for those out there, for Naomi and Sarah, that are our audience in the house, but for the other 600 that I know that are watching right now, School Sport Victoria, so our state is broken up into a sporting competition, and where you guys play sport after hours, all our sport is played in hours in primary school and high school. And so the school sport structure is, we've got, what have we got? Well, I think we've got something like 6,500 kids now statewide that are broken into 8 regions, and each region is then broken into 8 divisions. So it flows down, and each division then contains about 8 districts, and so on and so on. And there the schools fit. Now, Brett and I, we are region coordinators, so there's 8 of us. There's actually 16 of us, but Brett and I are both primary school. So there's 8 of us that organise events around the state. And so Richard is an ambassador for the entire state with sport. So it's a really cool thing for him to be on. All right, man, so I'm going to ask you a hard question, all right? And I know that you've got some great examples. And I want to know the negative PE teacher that you've experienced, or I know that you didn't really have it because you had such a great time at school, but the negative PE teacher that you may have heard about with one of the athletes you've coached, and what mistakes are they making so we can help them?
Yeah, I won't name names just because they're probably still teaching it a lot as well. So, yeah, I remember a lot of different stories through school, but there was always the ones who went, saw me push into class and went, oh, you're here, okay, now what do I do? And you see they just got that blank look on their face and they have no idea how to include a person in a wheelchair. And often it was, we've got AFL out here, which is our main sport in our state, and it's all, a lot of it's kicking drills and kicking the ball around in the air, and a wheelchair person can't really do that. So often it was me just pushing around, trying to keep up, and I found that a little bit frustrating, but I got involved whenever I could. So it was, I still see today when people don't be involved, they sit on the sidelines, or in Australia it's not as bad as I've heard overseas as well, so we are very lucky. But when I did sport, I actually competed for my school against a lot of other schools in the able-bodied division, so there was no disability at all or anything. I was considered another athlete, and I was ranked whatever I was in that sport. So if I was playing tennis, I would be the third or fourth in my year group, and I just had to play against the person on the other side who was an able-bodied. And I thought that was great, and I didn't get treated any different, no special rules, no. That was it. You were playing and you went along. So it was great in junior sport for us because that was fine. Up in high school, higher up, it didn't really work as well because that was a lot better. But in athletics, I went all through the finals in juniors. Then in seniors, they wouldn't let me compete because I'd win. But my school didn't ever win the championship. So my winning the one race weren't going to get the trophy for the school from like 11th out of 12 schools, I think it was. So, I was like getting a few points, not much.
Yep, awesome. Yep. So, Brett, I'm going to ask you this question. Sorry, I'm getting a bit of echo there. That's okay. But what can you tell me then, what can teachers do with students then that physically and cognitively cannot be involved? So there is something limiting them, but we're talking physical education. So, you know, I have a big beef when we talk about physical education, and the content is always driven around physical movement. But what can teachers do to make sure that there is some aspect there?
Yeah, absolutely, and I think one of the things to consider is that everyone's different and every case is different as well. So There's not necessarily a one-trick fixes-all sort of scenario, but I think, you know, the goal has got to be inclusion. So it may be, you know, if there are specific limitations on a particular student at the time, getting them involved in another way may be applicable. So it could be as a judge, or it might be working with the iPad to score or something like that. But I think another way, you know, the goal should always be to include them physically as well. So it might mean modifying the rules of the game, or modifying the way the game is played, or maybe putting limitations on the other students as well to include that student.
And that's those game sense strategies. It flows in, eh?
Yeah, that's it.
And whenever I was at school, we had that, and I remember the teachers would always put the strong, the tall kids, or the athlete, the really good PE kids in like the back court, and they could only go into like a certain part of the court or anything like that. So they limited their impact, so it wasn't just two best players going from each other, and the rest of the class were not involved. And I remember when there was like half the class was involved and then half the class wasn't. My school made sure everyone touched the ball or got involved in the activity. And there's many different ways to get the end result. If you've got their students got to do a certain activity, there's hundreds of ways to get to that end result. You don't have to do the Olympic standard weightlifting lift. You can do the lift in 10 different ways to be able to do that to achieve it. And every athlete can achieve
for sure.
the skill in different ways.
Yeah, absolutely. And so I've got five strategies there. So if you're out there, grab a pen. Or you can just watch this later and you can grab a pen then. So my five strategies work like this. Do your background. So you've got to know the kid. Build a relationship. Be very experimental. So set no limits. Let the child set the limits and then work to those limits. The fourth one is be adaptable and be visual. So I put them in together. And the fifth one I reckon is the most important one is to listen. And none of those things relate to any skills. None of those things relate to anything physical whatsoever. They all relate to being a great teacher. And Brett, you had five as well. Oh, no, yeah, four. I can see four.
I had a few there. So one was similar. Educate yourself. And what I mean by, and I can give you a quick, because we are running out of time, a quick example of a student I've taught in the past who had diabetes. And initially when I was presented, it was her first year of school, and she needed to her blood needed to be tested regularly, and we needed to be really aware of her blood sugar levels in phys ed in particular, because that had a major impact. And initially that was a really daunting thing for me, because I had no real knowledge of what diabetes was and what I was required to do. But the key was I educated myself. So my school was great. They sent me to a PD with experts, and I actually learnt what was required to help assist in managing this girl, what she could do at certain blood levels and all that sort of thing. And then once I had a much better knowledge, I felt more confident, and all of a sudden, you know, I was able to include her much better in the phys ed classes. So number one is educate yourself on the particular special needs of the student. Develop that relationship. I know Andy had a relationship as well, but develop a relationship with the family. So the parents are usually the experts. Parents are always experts on their children, on all children. So and having that strong relationship with the family, you're able to really work together and set goals and all that sort of thing. So and even not family and other members of the school. So it might be the classroom teacher, it might be another person in leadership at the school. If you can have that strong relationship, you'll definitely be kicking goals. Be prepared is a really good one as well. So most teachers, all teachers should be doing their planning for any session. And if you know you've got a child with special needs, you need to plan for that, and you actually need to document. You actually need to think, well, I need to change, or I need to adapt this particular session, and how am I going to adapt this particular session? So, and actually document that in your planning. I think that's really important, so that you're not sort of on the spot thinking, oh, how am I going to include this student, and having to make stuff up on the spot. You've actually thought about it before the session. And another really important one, I think, is to introduce students to a sporting pathway, and I touched on that before, is all students need to know that there is an opportunity for them to compete in sport outside of school or within school. So introduce them to that pathway. And as we said, Richard's a prime example of the School Sport Victoria system that we have here. He was introduced to that pathway at school, and he's gone on, and you know, and he's as a Paralympic champion and world champion. So they would be my main strategies.
Yeah.
Did you want to add to that, Richard?
Yeah.
Rich, did you want to add to that at all?
Yeah, I think that's great, but I also think that the teachers can't underestimate the students' abilities. I always believe to set a goal and then also put it really, really high. So if you want to do something, you've got to do it, and then push the student beyond ability, because most of the students I see coming through always say, oh yeah, I can't do this, I can't do that. But if you encourage them and get them involved, they will be able to blow their expectations way out of the water. So, and that's what we're trying to do as educators in the sporting side. We're trying to get them developing on an elite level as well. So because there is a world of opportunities out there, and we see them coming through the ranks into Paralympic sport, but you never know if they're going to be a Paralympic champion until you get them in sport and get them to push their abilities beyond what they believe they can do.
Oh, fantastic. Absolutely right. I know we're running out of time, so we've probably got enough time for one more comment, and then I reckon there's about a billion questions lining up. So the last question we had was, how do we manage bullying? And bullying exists. We can't put a Band-Aid on it anymore. We can't cover it up. They can't sweep it outside the gym. It happens. And if we don't counteract it, then it follows children around in life, unfortunately. And so with bullying, I guess while I'm talking, one of the strategies I love to do is again to make those large scale connections. And where, you know, I had a child in a wheelchair for the last 6 years, and this child faced a fair bit of bullying in his early days, and then he ended up being one of the captains of the school, and he went on to his own successes as well. But yeah, even in his last few weeks, there was kids that were picking on him because they believed that he had an easier pathway through to state championships than they did. But I made a point of making a large scale connection. So I'll just show you just a real quick snippet of what I showed the class, and you guys will you'll get a kick out of this. I know you'll get a kick out of this, Rich. Let me take my headphones out. Find it first. So you might know this person. You might see him close to you. I just keep dancing.
I love that. But so I love that. Showing, get it down to your tune to that one.
It does. It gets it going. But you might have recognised that person, and he's sitting right there. But it just shows having that large-scale connection and the idea of making a point of showing where a pathway is going to go is really cool. Small discussions, conflict corners, and dealing with things in a dealing with the negative in a positive manner, and that's really important too. Like, you know, turning things around. So where there's a negative, I'm not a negative person, and I see the positive in everyone and everything. And you know, I truly believe that I was put into this role to influence kids and influence teachers and really see the best in everyone, and that's what I carry on with kids as well. Brett, in your classroom, man, how do you deal with that bullying situation?
I'm a big fan of rights and responsibilities, really. So explaining to the kids about, you know, everyone has the right to feel safe, everyone has the right to learn, and if incidents occur, then you need to address them. So you need to address them with that student, and I just talk about, you know, you have the responsibility to make sure that everyone has the right to feel safe and to learn, and have that conversation with those students and say, look, at the moment you're not doing that, you're not upholding your end of the bargain, and you know, and just have that conversation. And I think you know, and maybe even, you know, having conversation with those students to educate them about the particular student that may have a disability or a special need, because sometimes I think bullying may come from a lack of understanding from the students too. So so educating them, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, awesome. And Rich, hit us, mate, from the other side. Did you suffer bullying? I know that, did you suffer it? Do you still suffer it? And how do you deal with it?
Yeah, so my school, my year actually was notorious for having a bit of a bad year, and it wasn't just me that suffered a little bit during school. And even now, that when you go back to the teachers, they know that year and the kids that were involved in my year. So I my outlet was sport. So if I had a bad day, I'd go and train hard, and got home and studied, and I wanted to prove that I could do everything and I was going to be successful in life. So I wanted to do better scores than everyone at school, but I also didn't want to be treated differently or separate, and that's what I found when it was I didn't enjoy life when I was treated as the different athlete, a different student in my class. So I don't think students should be separated, and I don't think they should be encouraged, like everyone should be made feel like they're separated into this disabled participant in the class or in sporting environments. So I like to be even, and if I've got to do exactly the same thing and it hurts me, then I'll do that. But I've seen it in the past where they've been separated and it's not the greatest. But I also don't believe students are inspiration for just participating in sport and doing the same thing as everyone else. So I don't think we should be making a big fuss of a student participating or going off and doing a school sport just for participating, just like every other classmate. I think they should be celebrated for breaking a world record, not just turning up on the start line. And that's where I'm now trying to change attitudes, where I'm not inspiration for doing normal things. I want to be inspiration for doing the crazy things, like Andy loves it, the death road. I pushed the death road the other year in my racing chair, like 65K down the death road. And
in Bolivia. Oh, man.
But I want to do something crazy, but I think a lot of people still see disability as, oh, that's amazing, but I get it, people, when you go to the supermarket going, oh, you're inspiration, but I'm not inspiration for going to the supermarket and buying milk and bread. That's no different to everyone else, and that's the image we're trying to get across. And I do a lot of disability awareness programs now, trying to teach the kids that, hang on, I'm no different to them. I've done my exams, I can drive a car, I've done university, I've done everything else. So, and the disabled kid in their class is exactly the same. It's not, they're not inspiration for coming to class that day. So it's important that we get that message across to every student.
Absolutely. Yeah. I know, Sarah, you flicked up there that Joe Bailey mentioned that, who does the disability awareness in their school programs. And Rich is my go-to guy for that. You know, I see him for athletics, I see him for swimming, cross-country, just questions about kids. And having a mentor like Richard is so important, because he, to me, is the ultimate knowledge. He's the one that makes sense of it. So now we've only got 5 minutes left, so let's go through our last question. Our last question that we put to each other was, the do's and don'ts. What message do we want to leave our audience with? Because unfortunately, we can't talk for 2 hours. We could talk for 2 hours, but you girls aren't going to let us. So, Brett, what are we going to leave our friends around the world with?
Yeah. So, So the point that Richard was just talking about, I think, is a really powerful one that I've taken out of this myself, is that, you know, we don't have to celebrate just participating. And that's something that I hadn't really thought of before we started planning this session. And literally last week, I have a boy that I'm teaching at the moment in grade three who has cerebral palsy. And we were doing sprinting this week as part of an athletics unit. And as part of one of those activities, everyone else in the class had finished, and he was still going, and he was doing a great job, and he was still going with the sprinting activity. And all the other kids who thought they were doing the right thing, they started to clap and cheer, and, you know, well done, you know, you're participating. And he said to me, can you please make them stop? I hate it when they do that. Because he's feeling, well, I'm just doing what you guys are doing. We're not cheering anyone else on for doing that. So whilst I think it's human nature to want to encourage and cheer for people, we need to consider how that may make them feel. And in many cases, you know, and certainly in this case with me, he didn't feel good about it because he was just doing what everyone else was doing. He didn't want to be singled out. He didn't want to be separated from the class in that sense. So that's the biggest message for me. And you know, and the main message I think is we need to focus on the ability of each student. We need to find a way to include them in all our classes rather than focusing on their disability. And, you know, we should never see kids just simply sitting out and not participating. Yeah. Over to you guys.
Absolutely. Go, Rich.
Yeah, exactly. Like, just summing it up, well, I think we shouldn't clap the kid who's just participating in sport, no matter who they are. I don't like that when I'm doing a road race or a track event. And even if you're winning or coming last, I don't think it should be clapped to coming last. That's my attitude with it, because I think you should be clapped for doing something amazing, not just participating. And I think whenever my school made a big fuss of me just participating is when I didn't like it. And I think a lot of people don't like that as well. So you've got to make sure they can do every activity in sport. If it's playing soccer, make sure they can be included. And that was the big thing I hope everyone takes out of that and gets a lot more information. And there's resources out there to help you to try and include everyone. And just don't make a big fuss. Just get them involved.
Absolutely. All right, so I'm going to have the final little one. And I'm going to get up and close for this one. And this may scare you, but it's almost like Halloween. And the whole secret around it is ownership to the kids and ownership to the children right across the board, whether they've got a disability or not. We talk about differentiated curriculum. We talk about inquiry models. We talk about personalized learning. These kids have to be allowed to make their own decisions. They've got to grow in life. If we are there to support them the whole way, they're not going to make the incorrect decisions. And who are we to decide whether that's an incorrect decision or not? It suits their needs. And so the ownership for athletes with disability is so important. And as teachers, we need to embrace that. We need to be able to just let go and go, okay, let's see what happens, and then model around that. And so far, the last 5 or 6 years, my parents that I've had in school have been so supportive of that. So that would be my final message there is have a look at those kids on Monday that come to your school and give them an opportunity to show you how they can shine. Make them smile, keep them happy, get to know them, build that relationship, build that connection. And these kids are amazing. They will find their pathway through life. You know, in 10 years' time, as teachers, we'll turn around and we'll go, I had that kid in my classroom. And now he's my boss. And so, but we've got to be able to do the right thing. And the doing the right thing is allowing that child to be able to follow life the way they want to follow. So, yeah.
Good work.
Awesome.
Yeah, that is us. That is full access PE. That is an intense hour. but, you know, it's so passionate about it because of the connections that we've made and the kids that you see in your classrooms and just being able to embrace all that. So I know on behalf of the three Australians that are sitting right here, we're so thankful to be involved in this and for you guys to be able to reach out and give us a small little time slot in a small little conference that is actually applied for by so many people. So it's cool. It's cool.
Yeah, thank you so much for joining us. For those that don't know, in Australia, it's like the wee hours of the morning for them. So they've been up a long time right now. So we appreciate them. What time is it, Andy?
2:51 a.m.
Yeah, and just to be clear, we want everybody to know, like, Andy's about to head off to train, and Brett's about to go coach, and Richard has a really big race today in just a couple hours. So thank
you. I race on Saturday, and I'm racing Sunday morning as well. So hopefully I'll get a few hours, and I'll be able to get on that start line tomorrow in a few hours.
Yeah, and we wish you the best of luck, and we just thank you so much for putting this together and bringing this group to our community. It's really unbelievable. And just for our viewers, a couple of reminders. There's going to be a conference survey posted on the Phys Ed Summit 4.0 homepage. If you complete the survey, then you'll get a certificate of attendance in exchange via email in case you need that for your school district. And if you have any questions, just hit us up on Twitter or email us.
Absolutely.
And if,
go ahead, Andy.
Oh, I was just going to say, we're more than welcome to come to your schools and do guest talks and that. It just might cost you an airplane ticket and maybe a hotel room.
Maybe bargain with them to do a hangout.
You're in the U.S. for a road race, so I'm in the U.S. a couple of times a year, so I'm always available when anyone's around.
So that's really important for our American, North American teachers there that follow Richard's pathways, because if he's in a town near you, he'll come and talk to your school for nothing. Maybe that's just awesome. A smile and a drink.
Perfect. All right, well, we got to move on to the next session, so thank you so much for participating with us. For all our attendees for watching, thank you so much. We appreciate it, and we'll see you in the next session. So have a great morning, everybody, and have a great rest of your day to the rest of our viewers. See ya.
Thank you.
See ya.
Bye.
Bye, guys. Thanks.